Morning. My name is Stephen Hobbs from the University of Kentucky. So great turnout for an HRCT session first thing in the morning. So warms my chest radiologist heart to see you all here. I don't have any relevant disclosures to this talk, and we're going to talk about pneumoconioses and when you should be considering them and the limitations of imaging and evaluating these patients. We are not going to get into the so-called B reader classification or the ILO classification, and we're not really going to discuss malignancy evaluation in these cases, although we will touch on a few concepts. So, occupational lung disease is actually a fairly big deal. So, certainly in the workplace, injuries related to pulling your back or trauma and those types of things are far and away the most common, but lung injuries actually are fairly common after that and account for a decent proportion of deaths per year related to inhalational injuries related to workplace. Now, pneumoconiosis specifically refers to a subset of occupational lung disease that's mineral-related dusts. So what diseases are we talking about? Well, there's the major types, the ones that you are likely to encounter at some point during your practice. That's asbestos-related inhalational injuries, silicosis, and coal workers pneumoconiosis. If you haven't seen those, maybe you missed them, or you know, you're in a part of the country that doesn't experience a lot of those, but chances are you'll see some of those if you read enough chest CTs. Now the minor types, very rare, and you may not encounter those in your clinical practice, but hopefully after today you'll have an idea of when you should start to think about these. So we're going to start off with asbestos-related disease. Long-term exposure generally required, but the clinical presentation, like pretty much everything we're going to talk about today, is nonspecific. Historically, asbestos-related mining and processing, construction, auto and railroad manufacturing, but that's not really true for the most part today. It's all about abatement, old buildings where somebody encounters asbestos and didn't realize it ahead of time and has an exposure related to that. So there's two major categories of inhalational disease related to asbestos exposure. The first we're going to talk about is asbestos-related pleural disease. Now, pleural effusions are actually the earliest sign of asbestos-related pleural disease, but those are almost never imaged, so we're not really going to get into that today, and it occurs earlier in the disease process. We're going to focus instead on pleural plaques and diffuse pleural thickening as asbestos-related pleural disease. Pleural plaques, usually seen 20 to 30 years later, they can calcify, and you get these circumscribed focal areas of pleural thickening, and I'll show you examples of what those look like and the variable degrees that they can have, variable appearance that they can have. You can also have diffuse pleural thickening. You could think of it as a pleural plaque on steroids where you get really significant pleural rind occurring. That can occur, at least in the literature, 9 to 22% of the time. I certainly don't see it quite that frequently in my own, you know, clinical practice when I'm evaluating these, but you know, according to literature, it can occur a fairly decent percentage of the time. Latency period, similarly, quite a long period of development for these abnormalities, and you end up with a smooth, uninterrupted pleural abnormality. And again, pictures are worth a thousand words, so we'll show you what some of this looks like. So these are pleural plaques. X-rays, you can have pleural plaques both en face, meaning in the anterior posterior pleura, where you're essentially looking this veil-like opacity, or in profile at the edges of the lung, where it occurs along the lateral pleural margin or along the diaphragm. So if you're looking here, this would be an en face pleural plaque. We can see this calcification on this full plate MIP reconstruction here, where you get these kind of scalloped and partially calcified edges. And that specifically is referred to as the holly leaf sign. So if you do see that and see these types of abnormalities, think, okay, I'm dealing with pleural plaques. Most of the time when a chest x-ray like this pops up, my initial thought is, oh, what is this? And then I finally think, oh, it's a pleural abnormality, and then I get on the right path. But it can be a little bit startling when you see it for the first time. Pleural plaques, especially in x-ray, hard to see. So X-ray is not really the ideal way to evaluate these cases. If you are looking, CT is the way to evaluate these. I think most of us would be hard-pressed to call a meaningful pleural plaque off the chest X-ray. You'd probably be hallucinating and squinting a little bit. There's one hiding here behind the rib. So you can see CT is really the way you want to be evaluating these cases. Pleural plaques can have a variable degree of appearance, right? Some of them are really elongated and very subtle. If you're not paying attention, I think a lot of people might blow past these small little pleural plaques. They're not calcified, but others can be more bulky with variable degrees of calcification, variable degrees of lobulation, right? So here, just giving you an idea of the variable appearance that you can have with pleural plaques, calcified, non-calcified, more elongated or more bulky. They do calcify over time. Progression of calcification in the setting of pleural plaques is measured generally in decades. I think there's a little over 15 years separating these two X-rays here, a calcified pleural plaque on FOSS, progressively calcifying over time, and even the world's tiniest little diaphragmatic calcified pleural plaque that was not calcified previously, calcifying over time there too. Now contrast that with diffuse pleural thickening. So an uninterrupted smooth pleural thickening, at least 5 centimeters by definition along the diaphragmatic margin, and then also 8 centimeters in the cranial caudal plane along the lateral margin. And it's important to diagnose this that you obliterate the costophrenic angle. So on this abnormality, this is on this chest X-ray, unilateral diffuse pleural thickening here on the left side. The costophrenic angle on the right side is not normal, but that's due to hyperinflation, not diffuse pleural thickening. There is not actual pleural thickening extending along the pleural margin here, just the hyperinflation as opposed to the left side. This is what it looks like on CT. Again, as you might expect, really this diffuse pleural rind, and just like pleural plaques, that can calcify as well. Don't confuse diffuse pleural thickening with extrapleural fat. Extrapleural fat will not obliterate the costophrenic angle. It undulates more and doesn't give you nearly as smooth and interrupted abnormality along the pleural margin. And on CT, it's fat attenuation, obviously, rather than soft tissue attenuation or calcified. So contrast asbestos-related pleural disease with asbestosis. And asbestosis specifically refers to pulmonary fibrosis, a lung parenchymal abnormality related to asbestos exposure, rather than a pleural abnormality. So if you use the term asbestosis, you are saying that the lung itself is abnormal, not the pleural space. Chest X-ray, normal in a vast majority, well, not a majority, in some of these cases. So again, high-resolution CT, including prone positioning, like you would evaluate other causes of pulmonary fibrosis, is really the ideal way to go. A majority of these will present with a UIP pattern of fibrosis, and a majority of these will also have abnormal pleural space in these cases, pleural plaques or diffuse pleural thickening, although some may not. And there are some clues to point you in the right direction, even if there are not calcified pleural plaques in these cases. Chest X-rays look like you might expect with any other cause of pulmonary fibrosis, lower lung predominant reticulation, increased interstitial markings, and traction bronchiectasis. And on X-ray, and so on CT, we see lower lung predominant reticulation, architectural distortion. There's no definite honeycomb cyst formation. You could call this a probable UIP pattern just based off of this, but don't forget to look at the pleural spaces and you'll see, oh, there are calcified pleural plaques bilaterally, clearly indicating the history of asbestos exposure in this case and confirming this is asbestosis rather than a case of IPF. If you don't see the pleural parenchymal, pleural-related abnormalities associated with asbestos, there are still findings that are more commonly seen in asbestosis than in IPF, and that's parenchymal bands and curvilinear lines. So you can see some examples here where you have these abnormal areas of band-like fibrosis extending out from the pleura, and then these curvilinear lines kind of in the subpleural lung as well. That type of, you know, kind of funny looking fibrosis, if you may, is more commonly seen in asbestosis than it is in IPF. So if you start to see that, think, okay, maybe I need to suggest that they take a more complete occupational history. Asbestosis, just like other causes of pulmonary fibrosis, can progress over time. 5 years difference between these two, showing a fairly substantial progression of the fibrosis in the lower lungs. And it wouldn't be an asbestosis talk if I don't at least mention round atelectasis. Remember, for this, you want all of these features to be present. You want a pleural abnormality. You want a broad-based pleural attachment to that. There should be a rounded opacity with volume loss. Notice how much volume loss there is here. The fissure has been pulled in because you've lost a lot of volume in the right lower lobe. And there's even a comet tail sign here pulling that bronchovascular bundle in towards this lesion. PET CT can be useful to evaluate these patients, as the FDG avidity is generally blood pool to slightly lower in the majority of these if you have a questionable case. These don't strictly require follow-up depending on your index of suspicion, but if it meets all those classic criteria, then generally this is round atelectasis. So we're going to switch gears a little bit now to silicosis and coal workers' pneumoconiosis. These are technically distinct diseases, but they have nearly identical imaging manifestations, one associated with coal dust inhalation, the other one with silica inhalation. The risk of pulmonary complication is really related to the length and intensity of exposure, and just like asbestos-related diseases, has a generally long latency. Things like mining, construction, glass, material processing, ceramics, foundries are all risk factors, occupations for these types of diseases. So what do we see? Perilymphatic nodules is the diffuse nodular pattern most strongly associated with both silicosis and coal workers' pneumoconiosis. And there's a great talk yesterday on diffuse nodular lung disease patterns to go over that. You can see emphysema in these cases, most frequently due to cigarette smoking, but sometimes you can see it just related to cicatricial emphysema and scarring as the fibrosis progresses. Lymphadenopathy, frequently calcified, and again, common theme here, chest x-ray is really inferior to CT for evaluating these cases. And one thing to keep in mind is that PET CT is likely to show a false positive uptake in these patients, so evaluating individual nodules in these cases with PET CT is generally not something you want to try to do. So what do those lymph nodes look like? Here's a classic bilateral hilar and mediastinal adenopathy eggshell type calcification pattern in the hilum and in the mediastinum, classic for silicosis-related mediastinal adenopathy. Here's an example of so-called simple pneumoconiosis. You have small little pulmonary nodules noted in the mid and upper lungs. There are small little centrolobular nodules, and then also nodules along the bronchovascular bundles, and then also nodules studding the fissures and along the subpleural lung. So this is a perilymphatic nodular distribution, so classic for simple silicosis. These nodules can progress over time. So 7 years difference between A down to B. B is 2 years later, and I think 3 years from baseline, and then 7 years from baseline down here. Progression of these small little so-called simple silicosis nodules here to fairly substantial hilar retraction, conglomerate opacities progressing over time, leading to so-called progressive massive fibrosis, as many of those small little nodules coalesce over time, giving you an increased degree of fibrosis and hilar retraction. So this is what it looks like off of CT as you develop that progressive massive fibrosis. You end up with perilymphatic nodules that have coalesced into these larger mass-like areas. They can have variable degrees of calcification and heterogeneity. It's not uncommon to see some low attenuation areas within these conglomerate opacities as well. A lot of hilar retraction, a lot of distortion. You can have emphysema associated just from the fibrosis here. Most of the time, they're relatively symmetric, but sometimes they can be fairly asymmetric in one lung or one lobe may be more involved than the others as well. You can also have silicoproteinosis occurring more frequently in the acute and subacute setting, where you end up with a crazy paving type pattern of multifocal opacities. And again, we saw a great lecture yesterday on a more in-depth look at the crazy paving pattern. We saw some examples earlier today as well. But keep in mind that crazy paving has a big differential, right? There's lots of causes of alveolar proteinosis, not just silica proteinosis, and there's even more causes of crazy paving in general, right? So it's something you can think about in this setting, but it's certainly not pathognomonic for this. And remember, just an example of PET CT and how these nodules are almost always avid on PET CT when you're evaluating them. So using PET CT to evaluate an individual nodule or mass in the setting of pneumoconiosis of silicosis or coal workers is generally not going to help you figure out whether or not that nodule is likely to be malignant or not. You can still use PET CT for extrathoracic disease, but not really for the lungs itself. So this was certainly, if you're just looking at it individually, a very suspicious looking nodule, right? But elsewhere in the lungs, there's additional evidence of pneumoconiosis, of coal workers' pneumoconiosis, and this was just a pneumoconiac nodule, not a malignancy. So the last kind of class of diseases we're going to talk about are those so-called minor ones. You're unlikely to encounter one of these. They're pretty rare, but they're good to have at least a baseline knowledge of what these may look like. So hard metal, cobalt lung, titanium, those types of things. Ground glass opacities and consolidation on pathology correlates with macrophages and multinucleated giant cells. This is on pathology, the so-called giant cell interstitial pneumonia that's pathognomonic off of pathology for this. You have those ground glass opacities and variable degrees of fibrosis to go along with these. The important part to remember here is that this fibrosis, like we'll show you, does not generally look like UIP pattern fibrosis. It looks much more unusual. So here's an example. Relatively mild disease, hard metal disease. The chest x-ray is fairly normal, frankly, a few tiny little nodular opacities, but I think a lot of people would probably blow past that and just call it normal and move on. On CT, we do see small little ill-defined ground glass micronodules with a little bit of architectural distortion, but it's mostly a ground glass nodular disease. So this is relatively mild disease related to hard metal exposure. But you can see here a much more progressive disease with a really profound degree of fibrosis and architectural distortion, traction bronchiectasis, and some ground glass opacities, and even some more confluent consolidation, right? I don't think anybody would call this a UIP pattern, and that's really the point, right? So if you have an unusual case of fibrosis, then you can start to think about these other diseases. Here's another one, welder's pneumoconiosis or siderosis. Again, common radiologic findings, not that different than hard metal, ill-defined central orbital nodules corresponding on pathology with those dust-laden macrophages, and then progressive degrees of fibrosis. So this is an example of siderosis, of welder's pneumoconiosis. Again, a relatively normal-looking chest x-ray, but we look to CT, and we see these fine little central orbital ground glass micronodules. Now, this to me, if I was reading it, looks a lot like that hypersensitivity pneumonitis cases that we saw just a little while ago, and I think that would probably be the lead thing in my differential, just looking off of this x-ray. Respiratory bronchiolitis, perhaps, or hypersensitivity pneumonitis. But in this case, it was actually due to welder's pneumoconiosis. Now, again, these are more advanced cases of welder's pneumoconiosis. Again, I don't think people would mistake these for classic cases of IPF or UIP, but there is really kind of bizarre-looking fibrosis here with some really profound lung destruction. Again, when you see these types of unusual patterns of pulmonary fibrosis, think to yourself, okay, could this be an inhalational injury? Similar again, aluminum pneumoconiosis in this case, really kind of an unusual pattern of a combination of airspace disease, ground glass abnormality, and bronchovascular traction and everything. So the last disease we're going to mention, chronic beryllium disease, caused by an inhalation and sensitization to beryllium. Now, most of us don't come into contact with beryllium, but people who work in the airspace injury, nuclear workers, and such could potentially be exposed to this. And depending on what they're doing, that industry may actually be screened for this disease. Clinical presentation, like a lot of what we've seen today, very nonspecific, and the latency is generally months to years as well. So, what does it look like? Well, lucky for us, or unlucky for us, depending on your perspective, it basically looks like sarcoid, right? So you have a disease process that from an imaging standpoint essentially looks identical to sarcoidosis, mediastinal hyaluronopathy, perilymphatic nodules, sometimes ground glass abnormality, and then it mid and upper lung fibrosis and a bronchovascular distribution, classic features of sarcoid. At a population level, the lymphadenopathy is usually not isolated in chronic beryllium disease, but in an individual patient, that would be difficult to use as a predictive feature for whether or not you have chronic beryllium disease or sarcoid. And the upper lung fibrosis in chronic beryllium disease is less common than what you typically see in sarcoid as well. But again, in an individual patient, you'd be hard pressed to use that for prediction. So these are both two different examples of chronic beryllium disease. If you're looking at them, I personally think they look a lot like sarcoid, right? They look like tiny little perilymphatic nodules, a bronchovascular distribution to many of these. They're studying along the fissures as well. There's a little bit of fibrosis to go along with these, a little bit of architectural distortion in both of these two different cases, and there's a few little larger conglomerate areas of opacity of nodularity too. And there's even a little bit of mosaic attenuation like you see in sarcoid sometimes too. These are both cases of chronic beryllium disease. Now, Some would argue that if you say sarcoid in your differential, you should probably put chronic beryllium disease in your differential too. So I personally don't do that because I feel like chronic beryllium disease is relatively unusual, at least in our patient population. But if you have a large aerospace industry in your group or something like that, then maybe this is something you should bring up. And it's certainly, if you're in a multidisciplinary discussion, something worth bringing up as well. So in summary, hopefully now you have a slightly better idea of kind of the spectrum of imaging findings that are specifically associated with the different occupational lung diseases related to mineral inhalation. Thank you.